Good morning. My name is Father Tom Keneally, and I'm the archivist of Xavier University. Today is Tuesday, December the 9th, 2008, and I'm seated here in the Brueggemann Center on the Xavier campus with Dr. Vytautas J. Bieliauskas. Dr. Bieliauskas is a distinguished professor emeritus of psychology at Xavier. I'd also say an esteemed colleague and good friend as well. And he's graciously agreed to be interviewed this morning for Xavier's archival collection of oral histories. First of all, Dr. Bieliauskas, I want to welcome you and thank you for your willingness to share with us today your memories of Xavier and your long association with it.
Glad to be with you.
Good. Let me begin at the beginning, if I may, and maybe you could tell us something about your life before Xavier. First of all, where were you born and raised?
I was born in Lithuania, in a rural household. My father was forester or forest ranger, I don't know what you call him here. And we were three brothers, three boys, and one sister there. And while my father's and mother's education was somewhat limited, they made sure that all the children finished university. All of my brothers and sister finished university.
Right, good. Good.
And so I finished grade school, finished gymnasium, and after I finished gymnasium, I went to the seminary college in Vilkaviškis, where I have studied philosophy and probably would have planned to study theology in and towards priesthood. But then I had to leave the country, and the seminary was closed, and life events changed everything.
Were any of your siblings still alive?
My sister is still alive. My two brothers passed away already. I was the oldest. Mm-hmm. Somehow I'm surviving.
Still with us. Yeah. Yeah. And your childhood in Lithuania, you obviously did your early education there?
Yes. Mm-hmm. In Lithuania, this usual gymnasium, it was 8 years. Mm-hmm. And grade school was 4 years. I went only 2 years. They allowed me to skip. Mm-hmm. And so I finished my gymnasium earlier than usual.
And that would have been when?
I finished 1939.
And then 1 year of philosophy studies.
Yeah.
And then you left Lithuania?
I had to leave Lithuania because as a student, I was involved in working with the Catholic groups. And we wrote some articles. I think I wrote one article which was against communism. The Russians were not in at that time. But once they came in, the article was picked up, and I was told clearly that they're going to deport me quickly. Mm-hmm. So some of the professors there at the college and my parents decided I should
leave.
Mm-hmm. They came on June 15th, the Russians.
The Russians.
Yeah,
the
Russians came in. Yeah, Soviets. Mm-hmm. And they came, and I decided to leave on August 25th, I went to the border, which was former Poland, but then it became German border, and there were Russian soldiers there, and I was told to hide, and then they made arrangements that when the soldiers were changing the guard, the Russians were to change the guard, they give the guns to those who remain, and the others go home without guns. Mm-hmm. So the farmer started making some noises for the cows there, which sounded like wasps or something. So they started running, and these soldiers were running after them. At that time, they told me to run.
And you ran across the border?
And I ran across the border. I didn't know where I went. I ran across the border in Germany. I didn't know even where it was, and the Russians began to shoot.
Oh,
and they were shooting, bang, bang. And the Germans, I didn't see anybody. Suddenly the Germans responded with machine guns. Oh, ta, 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 it was like crazy. So they let me go. Mm-hmm. And after that, the Germans picked me up. They wanted to check whether I'm not infiltrator. They put me into a refugee camp. I was there 1 month. And after that, they allowed me to leave and go to Berlin. In Berlin, we still had Lithuanian embassy, and there were Lithuanian community. So I went there, and they arranged me a little job for me, and I was working there. And at that time, they made contacts with the German Catholic charities. They were working close, and they selected some students where they would support. Mm-hmm. And I was one of them they selected. Mm-hmm. So where do I go? They said you should go to the south because it was not so dangerous. They, in the north, there were Russians fighting and everything there, and also the attacks on big cities, but try to get small cities. So what would I do? I took the map. I took a pencil and dropped the pencil down and hit Tübingen.
Tübingen, the city of Tübingen. Yeah. So you went from Berlin to Tübingen.
Tübingen, yeah. Mm-hmm. And in Tübingen there, there were some very famous theology professors, Adam, Steinbüchel, and so on. Yes. And there is allowed, I studied psychology, but I could go and attend those classes. It's mm-hmm. free university, so. Mm-hmm.
So you did your studies then, your university studies in Tübingen.
In Tübingen, yeah, Tübingen. Completely, yeah.
Is that where you received your doctoral degree?
Yes, I received
it. And when would that have been then?
It was in 1943, in December 1943.
You received your doctorate.
Yeah.
Well, in other words, you spent most of the Second World War in Germany.
Yes, yes.
What was life like in Germany during the Second World War?
When the Germans occupied, Russians occupied, the Soviets occupied Lithuania first, then in 1941 the Germans went in, occupied Lithuania, and then in 1942 I was allowed to go home and visit Lithuania. Mm-hmm. And while I was visiting there, I joined the underground, and they have made arrangements that I could get underground information, which I then sent to Switzerland and to Spain, mm-hmm. and then BBC would broadcast that.
Now this would be the anti-Nazi
anti-Nazi Lithuanian underground, yeah.
Okay.
Anti-Nazi underground. And
they sent the information you gathered to Switzerland?
Yeah. I would send to Switzerland. They send it to me, okay. And I used to get by Hitler's Mein Kampf. And I have bookbinder who would put those leaflets in there, put it together very nicely, and then we would ship it. I had so many Hitler's Mein Kampf, I kept buying them, and people thought I was super Nazi. I didn't bother to read it.
You helped to make it a bestseller.
That's right. That was available, that book. Then finally, they checked. And the guy who worked at the newspaper where he would transmit to me the information secretly, they got him, they tortured, and he gave my name. And then they arrested me, put me in Gestapo jail, and they said that I will go to Dachau, to concentration camp. And took me from Tübingen to Stuttgart. I was there in jail. And they were waiting and waiting, and I didn't know what they were waiting for. Turned out to be that there was a guy from Berlin to come to interrogate me because he wanted to know what the underground is. Mm-hmm. He had all the information. In those days, they didn't have Xerox and things like that. Mm-hmm. The night before he came to Stuttgart to see me was an air raid over Berlin, and they wiped out the house where he was, and he was killed. And all the information was gone. So I was sitting there, and finally they didn't know why. Mm-hmm. And finally they let me out under police supervision, and I stayed under police supervision most of the time.
Mm-hmm. After the Second World War, when it ended in Europe, I guess that would have been in early 45.
Yeah, I was in Munich at the time. After Tübingen, I went to Munich. I became scientific assistant and then senior assistant. I was teaching at the University of Munich. Junior faculty member, so to say. Mm-hmm. And when the war ended, the university was bombed out and so on, the Germans went through procedure to denazification. Mm-hmm. all the professors could not be denazified. I was the only one who could be denazified.
You denazified, all yeah. right, okay.
And so I could, I had to sign the salary voucher for my boss. Mm-hmm. Germans didn't like that. I didn't like it either, but that, in any instance, after that, everything happened, I saw that it would be better for me to get out of Germany because I couldn't go to Lithuania. They would have taken me to Siberia.
And by that time, of course, it was under Soviet
Russians,
control.
Yeah, yeah, the Soviet control. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't go there, and I couldn't, but I could go to the United States. So I came to the United States under the auspices of displaced persons.
So you were you came to these states as a displaced person.
As a displaced person.
And that would have been what year then?
49. Yeah. 49. My wife and one son was born at that time.
Where did you meet your wife?
In Munich.
In Munich, yeah. All right.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know her. She's Lithuanian, a physician, mm-hmm. and she was, she came to Munich as a refugee later on. I was one of the early refugees. She came as a refugee there, mm-hmm. and then stayed. She couldn't go back, and we met and mm-hmm. got married, and one son was born there, older son.
How many children do you have?
We have four children.
Four children. Are all of them in the United States?
Yeah, mm-hmm. two boys and two girls. The oldest one who was born in Germany is interesting. We came there and was listed. We came under Lithuanian quota, and he came under German quota. Uh-huh. he was 10 months old, so it didn't make any difference.
At that point. Yeah. Well, you came to the States in 49, and where did you settle?
I came to Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. I had there two, Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, coal mining town. There was two cousins of mine were there.
I see.
And they took us in for a while, and then they thought that I should work in coal mines. I said, no, I'm going to work at the university. So I went to the university at the King's College, Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, that I took my cousin's daughter, my niece, to interpret because I didn't speak English. So the priest who interviewed me, it was a Catholic school, he said, you speak Italian? I said, no. I said, do you speak French? He said, no. German? He said, no. He said, Latin? I said, yes, try it, because I had 8 years gymnasium with Latin.
Sure, sure.
So my first interview was in Latin, and he said, if you know that much Latin, you should be able to learn English. So he hired me.
And you did.
Well, I learned that. It was unbelievable in 3 months.
Yeah. My, 3 months.
Oh, yeah, the whole summer I just tried to learn everything. They told me to go and see movies or something like that. So I would go see movies and suddenly learned very nice cowboy language. You see? They told me that would not be good for the university.
How long did you stay there then?
1 year.
1 year.
And after 1 year, I went to actually 1 year because at that time they told clearly my wife cannot get license to practice medicine.
Oh, and as far as I'm a doctor, yes, yeah. I think we should.
And I could not. My salary was just terrible, and they paid me $3,000 for 12 months. Mm. Even the dollar was more valuable, but family of three to survive was impossible. So then I contacted, through newspaper advertising, Richmond Division of the College of William and Mary, which was called Richmond Professional Institute. And I went there, and they were very generous. They gave me salary $1,000 more, $4,000. Mm-hmm. Which was great.
A generous increase.
Generous increase, yeah. Yes. And by that time, the president of the King's College said, you should have told me, we can give you $4,000. I said, that's too late. Mm-hmm. I signed the contract. Mm-hmm. So I went there and stayed there for 8 years.
Did that school become Virginia? It became Virginia University.
Virginia Commonwealth University. Actually, I started there. And the department chairman there was somehow after 1 year quit. So I got a whole mess there. I had to reorganize the department and spend 7 more years and get master's degree program going, preparing for doctoral program. When my successors came, they had everything ready and they just moved in. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
And then after that, we had a problem there. We lived, my wife got a license. She practiced in the country, Newcomb County. And in Newcomb County was a terrible racial situation, they decided to close the schools, public schools, because they didn't want to admit black children.
Ah, I see.
So we had to explain our children how this is going, and we started feeling very uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we started looking for where the racial situation would not be so bad. Mm-hmm. And one of my students there in Richmond was from Cincinnati.
I see.
And he kept telling how great is in Cincinnati. So I saw the advertising and applied here and applied at Loyola. Mm-hmm.
The Loyola University at Loyola, in Chicago.
Loyola in Chicago, and Loyola in Chicago offered me a job. But Father Herr, who was department chair at that time, wrote me a letter. He said, I realize you were department chairman in Richmond. I want you to be to clear understand that you can never be department chairman at our university. Only Jesuits can be department chairman.
Oh, yes. So by this, of course, Jesuit University. Yeah. Yes.
By the same time, I interviewed at Xavier here, and Xavier McCoy was dean. Mm-hmm. Hailstones was chairman of the department, and psychology chairman was Ignatius Hamel.
A layman?
Nobody raised that question. So I said, I know I don't want to be chairman, but I don't like this kind of a restriction. Mm-hmm. So we chose Xavier.
So you were really hired by Dr. Ignatius Hamel.
And interviewed by McCoy, by Father O'Connor.
Who was president? O'Connor, yeah, president.
Father
at the
Paul
time.
O'Connor, Father Niporti.
Oh, yes.
They interviewed me and hired, and I was teaching for
what year did you come? That would have been 1958.
In 1958. And I was teaching for 1 year. At the end of the year, apparently Dr. Hamel's health was failing somewhat, his vision was not working. And I didn't realize that Dr. McCoy and Father O'Connor were already planning me to make me a chairman. Mm. I was not planning on that. I was just being a regular teacher. Now, what happens then, in the spring semester, I got a letter from Father O'Connor saying, please look at the schedule, prepare a schedule for the faculty, for the next year of classes. Uh-huh. So I thought, well, that's Dr. Hamel is not well, so I'm helping him. I prepared everything myself, full load, nothing happened. I came in the fall, came to teach. The dean at that time, I think it was Father Wurttemberg or something.
Father Henry Wurttemberger, yeah. Yes.
And
yes.
He said to me, we have to move your office. My office were in the barracks, army barracks. So
where was that located, the army barracks?
Where Alter Building now is.
Where the Alter Building now is, yeah. Okay.
There was army barracks, it's simple. And so I was transferred to a house which was where now Bellarmine Chapel is. There was a little house.
Yeah. There was a house there. Yeah. The Boylan Hall, I think they called
probably,
it.
Probably. Yeah, I don't remember. But I said, why do you transfer me? He said, you are department chairman. I said,
this was the first you knew it?
I didn't know about it. I said, I was never appointed. So I said, I would like to negotiate that. He said, I wouldn't advise you to do that because Father O'Connor will be very ticked off. So he said, just sit still and do it. So I did it. And this went on and on. I never was appointed as department chair.
How long?
For 18 years.
18 years you remained chair.
And Father...
Never having been appointed.
No. And Father Brennan... when he was academic vice president, he said, I don't know what to do with you. You have been so long chairman. The time would be to release you. I cannot do it. You never have been appointed.
Never appointed in the first place.
Yeah, but then finally after 18 years,
Well, how many hours did you teach each semester when you first
in the beginning, 17 hours.
17 hours?
Yeah.
My. And you became chair after just one
year? And then there was no extra pay for being chair. Then later on, second year after I was here, I got an offer from UC. They were paying $17,000. University of Cincinnati wanted to get me for 19 and a half. And I discussed that with McCoy. I said, I will have to leave probably. So 3 days didn't pass. Father Niporte called me and said, we have decided to increase your salary.
Oh, yes.
And they matched the salary, so I stayed.
Well, what were your first impressions of Xavier?
I said, was a male school, strictly male school, mm-hmm. kind of strong discipline. Academic standards impressed me. Mm-hmm. I always liked academic standards, so we could do this at that time. Mm-hmm. Department of Psychology was Dr. Walter Clark used to call refugium peccatorum. Mm-hmm. Everybody in
when the second sinners, yes.
Everybody went there where they couldn't get in anything else. So we decided to change that, and our department reduced in size, but increased in value, and then suddenly we got more students. At that time, by the way, when I was told that I will be department chairman, I went to my faculty members at that time, Dr. Walter Clark, Mr. LaGrange,
Glenn LaGrange.
Father Reinke.
Father John Reinke?
Yeah.
Yes, Father John, who later went to Loyola in Chicago, yeah. I believe. Yes.
No, in Indianapolis.
Indianapolis
first. Mm-hmm. And so I asked him, what do you think? Do you want me to be chairman? Dr. Clark said, well, I don't know. We'll look at it. If you do a good job, we'll be all right. We'll support you. If not, we'll do something to get rid of you. So we had very good understanding, and they were very supportive. I had no problem with the faculty. Yeah.
You talked about the administrators in those days. Maybe you could describe some of them for us. Father O'Connor, Father Kneeporty.
O'Connor was, there was a difficult, financially very difficult time.
Ah.
And he was...
late
50s was a very difficult time. I remember that one time as Christmas bonus he gave to each faculty member $10. Mm. He couldn't give it anymore, so it was a difficult time. But he was very good. Father O'Connor had one thing. If he appointed you to something, he said, you do the job, I will not interfere in any way, mm-hmm. and if I don't like what you're doing, you will be gone.
Be out.
Yeah. Okay. And so, and he also, I tried to introduce the master's program, which succeeded.
Mm-hmm. You did introduce
it. Oh, yeah, master's program in a very decent, good program. Mm-hmm. And then after that, I wanted to get a doctoral program, and Father O'Connor said, you know, what we do here at Xavier, we do either do right or we don't do it. Mm-hmm. And I don't think so we're in position to support PhD program here, so we're not doing it. Mm-hmm. Don't do it. And so I couldn't get, but the plans were made there, and...
The seed was sown.
Oh, yeah, the seed was from the beginning there. Mm-hmm. And, of course, it was very difficult for us to get faculty because psychologists were very rare at that time. Mm-hmm. So what I tried to do is to try to get our own students to place them into doctoral programs and then try to get them back.
Oh, okay.
And so this way, quite a few faculty members are our own graduates.
Whom did you hire in your years
as
chair?
I hired Cronenberger, Quatman,
General Quatman,
Dave Helkamp, Norm Berry. Chris Dacey was a student at that time. Chris Dacey was hired later on. Mm-hmm. And Helkamp was a student, and he was not. What we did, in order to enable us to survive, our salaries were very low. We made arrangement with Longwood State Hospital, where our faculty members could work part-time there.
I see.
And teach. And they would get extra
supplement
the income.
Yes.
And that way we had quite a few assistantships for our graduate students. Mm-hmm. And that way we could survive better and get faculty. Okay. So Dr. Hans Schmidt, his experimental psychologist.
Hans Schmidt. I remember him, yes.
And so the faculty were growing, we're adding this. Dr. Norman Berg, we still here, mm-hmm. was also with Longwood. So what we do, we would get them back, like Dr. Nelson, for instance. I send him to Virginia Commonwealth
Michael
University.
Nelson,
yeah,
yes.
Michael Nelson. Then to Virginia Commonwealth, he came back. We hired him for Longwood State Hospital. And then we hired him full-time at Xavier. Mm-hmm. And then he became department chairman. They succeeded me. Norm Berry was graduate from University of Toledo. Helkamp was our graduate. Nelson, our graduate. Now Chris Dacey is also a former student of mine. So they all are my friends.
Within the field of psychology, what is your own specialty? What have your particular interest in the
clinical
field?
Psychology and family psychology.
And family psychology. Mm-hmm. What were the students like when you first came to Xavier in 58?
Well, they were, as I say, all male students.
All male? Mm-hmm.
Male, and they were pretty much, you know, very disciplined. We had universal ROTC.
Oh, that's right.
Everybody was there, and so on. And actually, more or less, we could, whatever faculty said, you do it. It was like army discipline.
Unquestionable,
yeah.
How did the students change over the years?
Well, we got we became coeducational.
In 69, that's right.
Mm-hmm. In 69, we became coeducational.
Was there opposition to that at the time?
My daughter, oldest daughter, was one of the few, the first few women, who came here. And one of those who opposed women being here was Father English professor.
Oh, Thomas Savage.
Father Thomas Savage.
Yes.
He was totally opposed, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I remember that my daughter couldn't get an A in his class because she was a woman. That was not discrimination in those days.
She just didn't deserve it.
But then 3 years later, when my other daughter came, and there were many more women here, he was as friendly as he can be to her. Mm-hmm. Aldona remembers him as a very nice, friendly, and so on. But in the beginning, he was fighting. We wanted to have male school. And I think it's good that finally it changed. I think it has the image of the university has changed, but I think it's for the better.
And of course, during the late 60s, you know, the students changed rather radically too. Those were very awkward years.
Oh yeah.
The years of rebellion and so forth.
Oh yeah, sure. Yes. We had this year.
Yes.
We were, some universities were closed. We were not closed. We were, we had people coming from UC to boycott us, to encourage that we stop attending classes, and our ROTC people took baseball bats and told them to get lost.
And then, who were your close friends in your years at Xavier? People with whom you were, people you admired?
Well, I think Ray McCoy, we were very close. We used to go to Florida with his family to vacation. Mm-hmm. And his brother-in-law, Lozier.
Oh, yes, Gilbert Lozier.
Yes. Yeah, he was there. Mm-hmm. And then Father Felton.
John Felton?
Yeah. But as Father, let's see, Father Dieters was a good friend.
Oh, Richard Dieters.
Yes, Richard Dieters, dean of the Evening College. Mm-hmm. Father Foley was a good friend of mine.
Daniel Foley, yes, who was in your department.
Yes, yeah, he was in our department. I talked him into going to Ottawa to get his doctorate.
And he did.
Yes, he did.
Back here, yes.
I did that with several people. Dr. Kronberger was sent in there to get a doctorate. Chris Dacey got a doctorate there. Mm-hmm. And also Dave Helkep. Mm-hmm. So I had there some people whom I knew. Mm-hmm. And we used to do this. We would pick out good, really excellent graduate students to send them to doctoral schools. And some of the chairmen or committees there, they said that if you send and guarantee that a good student will take him in.
Whoa, that's high praise.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's high.
And we used to do that, and all our students, whoever went there, graduated, got free scholarships and so on.
Wonderful. And I'm sure in the long years that you've been here, you've served on various committees.
Yes, no.
Faculty, some more memorable faculty, than other, faculty, faculty committee?
Yes, I was faculty committee chairman. And then DiIulio came.
That's right, Albert DiIulio.
Albert DiIulio came. Mm-hmm. I was faculty committee chairman at that time.
Father Hoff came to Xavier
as a
president. Yes. And so, do you remember in the late 60s, there was a committee set up to revise the core curriculum?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that was, I understand, quite a long
battle. And we had to, what we achieved there, we included psychology into the science
module.
Yes. It was quite a fight. Mm-hmm. There's only science departments. Our students had to take 6 or 10 hour science, biology, chemistry, physics. Mm-hmm. We decided to get at psychology. Mm-hmm. It was quite a battle, but we had Father Peters, who was a good friend of mine.
Joseph
we worked,
Peters, who and was a biologist.
Biologist, and we worked on some research together and so on. So he thought psychologists could be scientists. Mm-hmm. And then
he was an important ally, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. And then Hart.
John Hart.
John Hart.
In the physics department.
Oh, yeah, psychophysics. He liked psychophysics. Mm-hmm. So we talked with the only one who was a little bit reluctant was chairman of the chemistry department, but they went along. Mm-hmm. And that program, that course is called General Experimental Psychology, and it's existing even now.
That's right.
And this is a very important thing for the department. It's a bread and butter course. Mm-hmm.
And it does fulfill the science requirement.
Absolutely.
In the core to this day.
Yeah, today, important to this day, and they have the program that was, the way we designed it, is working very well.
Mm-hmm. As you look back at this, what do you regard as your most significant contributions?
I think Father O'Connor allowed me to do what I thought I best can do, and that was great, mm-hmm. because some other presidents later on were not so generous, mm-hmm. but he was very generous and he allowed to do what you want, if you're doing it right. Mm-hmm. If not, he will warn you. Quality program, absolutely. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And I think we contributed to quality program. The psychology department became one of the leading departments, mm-hmm. and actually my students who succeeded me as chairpersons, they have continued my work towards doctoral program, introduced doctoral program in psychology.
And I think you're absolutely right. I think psychology has remained one of the university's really strong departments.
And after the doctoral program was introduced in 2005, mm-hmm. they gave me honorary doctorate's ID.
Very good. Uh-huh.
So that is nice to have it. I appreciate that.
As you look back over your years, who were the individuals, in your opinion, contributed most to Xavier's success over the last 50 years since you've been here?
I would say Hailstones, mm-hmm. Thomas Hailstones. Mm-hmm.
Thomas Hailstones, who founded the business school.
Oh, yeah. He founded business school, Ray McCoy, graduate school in the Department of Education. Mm-hmm. We worked very closely. He was dean of graduate school, chairman of the Department of Education. Psychology was kind of under his wing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had quite a few battles, I think. I got out from his wing because we wanted to be independent, and it was fine. You can argue with Ray McCoy, but he accepts. When the things are done well, he was accepted and so on. Father Felton was dean of undergraduate school. He decided at one point to divide classes, because some classes in psychology were taught by education department, some by us.
Oh, yes.
So he decided to, and then he decided that, for instance, psychological testing will be taught by Department of Education. some other classes, like personality theory, would be taught by psychology, and so he mixed it up. Some of those classes, like psychological testing, is genuine psychology class. Mm-hmm. So finally, Ray McCoy said, you know what? We just forget about Father Felton. We do the way we did. We're not fighting anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so that way, I think Ray McCoy contributed a great deal to Xavier, so the Thomas Hailstones, and many others.
Bob Helmes, I'm sure you worked with
him.
Yeah,
I remember you worked even in college. Father Dieters.
Father Richard, both of whom really built up the evening school.
Oh, yeah, very much so.
Yes, they were really responsible for its success at a time when that was a very important contributor to our economic welfare.
Absolutely, absolutely. And he was also, it was an interesting thing. Being department chairman, I had three bosses, dean of graduate school, mm-hmm. dean of arts and science, and evening college. Mm-hmm. And I found that was wonderful. Mm-hmm. Because when you have three bosses, mm-hmm. they don't know who allows you to
divide
do what.
Divide and conquer.
Yeah. No, not divide, I just do it. So they think the other guy let you do it. And so it was very fun, mm-hmm. no problem.
What would you regard as the most significant things that have happened at Xavier in 50 years? I guess going co-ed would certainly be one.
Going co-ed would be one. Increasing the academic standards, I think they are very high. Mm-hmm. And also the building, construction of the campus.
Yes.
When we came here, since that time, dormitories, only Brockman Hall was there when I came.
When you came, that's right, there was Brockman.
Brockman and Ellett, yeah.
So there were two dormitories when you came
that's
in
right.
58.
And there was where Joseph Building is, there used to be a cafeteria for clubhouse. There was
the old red building, yeah, the students called it, yes. Yeah. Which I think was the original building on the grounds when the for Jesuit the, purchased it in 1911.
Yeah, but that was the building for the, that was country club there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so other buildings, all the buildings, the whole, you know, were built since we were here. I think it was chemistry was here, mm-hmm. and physics. Was. Yeah, the whole
But Bellarmine Chapel.
Bellarmine Chapel was not built. Alter building was built since. Kuhlman Dormitory, Hussmann Dormitory was built.
The library.
The library was built.
The Schott Building.
The Schott Building. Yes. So it is really.
In fact, there wasn't even a university center when you first came. The university center, I think, was built about 65.
Yeah, but that center was kind of eliminated. Now new one was built.
That's right, and put in its place.
Yeah. Yeah.
How would you compare Xavier today to the Xavier you first knew?
Well, I think Xavier now is, we were struggling to maintain ourselves at that time, to maintain our status, to prove that we can do things. We don't need to do that anymore. Everybody knows that at Xavier people are quality people. They mm-hmm. do a good job. Mm-hmm. And the interesting part is that cooperation between faculty, Jesuits and laymen, we never had any problems. Mm-hmm. And we then didn't feel like that you would be a second rate type of person because you were not Jesuit. Mm-hmm. You did your job and they did their job, and we had interesting phenomenon. When we had department meetings in the Department of Psychology, we couldn't have it on first Friday because the Jesuits had to do the church service. So I introduced department meetings second Friday. Mm-hmm. And can you believe it that that is still in force?
Is that right? Yes.
Second Friday of each month, their meeting as department.
The meeting takes place.
And they don't know why.
Over the years, you have brought some important figures to Xavier.
Well, we had Riley. Or? We had Riley Foundation giving us the money.
Mm-hmm. And on was the, this an endowment of some kind?
It was. There was a couple who had produce business downtown Cincinnati.
I see.
They saved some money and then they died, and before dying established a foundation. Mm-hmm. And this foundation were giving money to different places. And we discovered that they would give a little bit for the blind, a little bit for the social, for Catholic charities, a little bit for this. So Ed Vonderhaar, who was vice president.
Oh, Ed Vonderhaar.
Yeah, he said, let's go and talk with them. So we went and talked with them and tried to convince that instead of giving some money to all these agencies, give it to the university who are training these people.
I see.
And so we prepared a program, submitted that, and they decided to give it. Mm-hmm. And they started giving $10,000 later on. In years to come, they grew and grew. The last time I remember, we got $50,000 mm-hmm. from them. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful, wonderful thing for us. In the beginning, we couldn't do much with it. We used that money to bring some outstanding psychologists here. Mm-hmm. So paying the trip and a little honorarium. Yeah. We gave honorary doctorate to Dr. Abraham Maslow.
Yes.
And brought him here.
That was
here.
Quite a coup.
Oh, yeah. We brought him here, and was... it was a good for us because the whole American Psychological Association admired us that we did that.
Oh, okay.
And we were, incidentally, I and some other faculty members were quite involved in American Psychological Association. I was president of two divisions, and so we were known there. Mm-hmm. And we used the money we brought, for instance, Magda Arnold,
From Loyola in Chicago,
yeah. Who was a very known psychologist. She did research in emotion, measuring of emotions, and she was teaching the Medica perception test. Then we brought Dr. Zygmunt Pietrowski from Temple University, who's a specialist in Rorschach, mm-hmm. spent here 2 weeks. We would get them for a semester or for 2 weeks because the money was limited. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, we could get them here, and that was very good.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And actually, unfortunately, that money from the foundation is not being received anymore, but as long as we received it, it helped me. At one point, when I retired, I became Riley Professor of Psychology, mm-hmm. and my salary was paid from that foundation.
Right. Yeah. What are your fondest memories of Xavier?
I would say I felt very comfortable here. This is my, like my real home, academic mm-hmm. home. And we had all my children graduated from Xavier. We worked together. We have we helped also outside Catholic charities, mm-hmm. the Mount Sinai Seminary, and so on. Mm-hmm. And probably the fondest memory was is that I felt at home, was accepted, and even now, after I'm retired, I still don't feel like I have been written off. Mm-hmm. I still come. I have a chance to. I have an office which I share with somebody, right. and I come and do some consultation with students. I teach a class in house three-person projective testing. That's my specialty. Mm-hmm. So to the students, and I used to teach more classes, but I tried to get out of it. This one I cannot get out of it because my specialty. Mm-hmm. And I'll be teaching that in the spring semester too.
Mm-hmm. How's your basketball these days?
Well, still going.
You play, how often do you play?
Three times a week,
wonderful.
Yeah. Well, this is play. Uh-huh. The people who are playing, they're kind of considered. They are not allowed to knock me down, so that's great.
They better not.
No,
and you've also been very involved in Lithuanian affairs.
That's right.
Over the
yeah.
years.
Oh, yeah.
We have. You go back frequently, do you, to Lithuania?
I was last year in 2007. Mm-hmm. I taught at the University of Vilnius there.
I see.
And as one of the of my students was finishing his dissertation, so I went there and allowed him to defend the dissertation.
Wonderful.
That was my last work there at the University of Vilnius. But I was quite involved when Lithuania declared the independence. I went there several times.
Wow.
I was president of the Lithuanian World Community.
Which community?
Lithuanian World Community.
World
representing
community.
All the Lithuanian communities.
Okay.
And so by virtue of that, I participated very active there in rebuilding of the country. And now I have contacts with them. And
Have governmental contacts?
Government contacts, I could have them, but mm-hmm. I really don't.
When
well,
do
the
you?
New prime minister is a friend of mine who has mm-hmm. just been appointed, mm-hmm. but they wanted me to be. I was advisor to the president for 6 months there.
I say president of the country.
Yeah, of the country, I stayed there. Bieliauskas, president. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he was, I was there, and I think I helped a little bit, but after a while I discovered that they do not like people coming from another country mm-hmm. and trying to influence the president. So I gently eased out because I didn't want to upset people.
As you look back over your years at Xavier, are there any regrets, any unfulfilled dreams? Maybe not.
Probably not. There would have
That's
been no doctoral would have been unfulfilled dream.
Mm-hmm.
But
it was
fulfilled.
Eventually fulfilled.
It fulfilled.
And that's to Xavier's advantage.
Yeah.
When did you retire then?
1988.
So you retired 20 years.
20 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And what are you doing in retirement?
Well, I have done some private practice. This year I decided not to renew my license in psychology.
I see.
Yeah, I will not practice anymore. And then I did some consultation with students on their doctoral dissertations and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And
I know you help out with examinations on occasion.
Yeah, I do that. Yeah. And so actually, it seems to be there's always something to do. I don't
that's
feel like
around.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it is. I hope that all this economy and so on will not do too much damage to Xavier University because we're in the process of developing
so much,
but it is needed what it's planned.
Yeah, that's right, the buildings, off quadrangle.
Yes. It's a very courageous step what Father Graham is doing. I'm admiring him.
Yes. Is there anything else then that you'd like to say for the records and for our history that I forgot to ask about? Or have we covered things pretty well?
I think so. I think mm-hmm. so. I think I consider Xavier as a very nice place to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I would not, I feel even after 20 years retirement, I still feel very comfortable here.
Well, I can't think of too many people who have contributed as much as you have.
Well, I don't know. I did what I supposed to do.
And did it very well. Yeah. Well, this will conclude our interview. Thank you very much, Vytis, for
You're
being
very
with
welcome.
Us today.
And, thank you for inviting
I think
me.
We found this very interesting and very enlightening, and this will become part of our history. Thanks
Thank
much.
You. Thank you. Yeah.